Good morning. It's great to see a full room. I have to share with you that I was actually one of the attendees of the very first National Pancreas Foundation Fellow Symposium in 2006. I think it was in, was it in Baltimore? I think it was Baltimore, with some of the other attendees in the room. We were sharing memories last night. It's great to see how this conference has grown through the years. And I would like to, first of all, thank the board for inviting me, but also congratulate NPF because I think this symposium is extremely important, and many of us have the opportunity to collaborate, network, and grow through this symposium over the years. And I will actually prove that during my talk. We're going to talk about fluid resuscitation studies in acute pancreatitis. I would like to share with you that pancreatic diseases in general is a great field to work and do research because we don't know much. We don't have a lot of treatments available. So actually today my whole talk will be about intravenous fluids. Someone might say, is it actually treatment giving fluids to patients? It is in acute pancreatitis. Recently, the new AGA guidelines that were published last year mentioned that fluid therapy to prevent hypovolemia and organ hypoperfusion is a long-established cornerstone of the initial management of acute pancreatitis. However, the evidence basis for fluid therapy in acute pancreatitis is still relatively weak. Going back in the late 80s and early 90s, there were animal studies that have shown us that microcirculation is impaired in experimental severe pancreatitis. And as you can see in this, clearly in this diagram, the capillary flow is significantly diminished in animals with severe pancreatitis. Going even further, studies in animals showed that pancreatic vascular perfusion is attenuated by large volume crystalloid infusion. And that was back, as we said, in late 80s, early 90s. Following that, we had the first human studies, and these studies were retrospective. And as you can understand, there is a lot of bias when we actually analyze retrospective studies, but they were very insightful in many ways. And as you can see, Tim was and Santi Vigi were pioneers in those studies that supported that early intravenous hydration with faster rate reduces in-hospital mortality, organ failure, ICU admission, and duration of hospital stay. And following that, there was a lot of enthusiasm that, about early and aggressive fluid resuscitation, and that was also reflected in the GI Society guidelines that were published in 2013 that did advocate for early vigorous fluid resuscitation in acute pancreatitis. Why early fluid resuscitation in acute pancreatitis? Because it's very important to maintain the volume status in hospitalized patients. And acute pancreatitis, it is indeed an acute inflammatory illness. And with early fluid resuscitation, we can improve local tissue perfusion and oxygen delivery. And this can impact disease course and in a way reduce the chance of tissue necrosis, but also systemic inflammation and organ failure. Following the previous retrospective studies, now we're moving in the early 2010s, and a couple of studies by my close friend Enrique Di Mararia from Europe actually reported, the first one was a prospective study, that if we actually give a lot of IV fluids during the first 24 hours, this can be associated with increased risk of persistent organ failure and acute fluid collection. Again, this was a prospective study, but it was not a randomized controlled trial. Following this, a second paper, which was an international collaboration between several centers, suggested that aggressive fluid resuscitation in the first 4 hours is associated with less need for invasive intervention, but was no different in other outcomes. And indeed, there might be actually two phases of fluid resuscitation, and the really early phase of it might be the first 6 hours of presentation when the patients are mainly in the emergency room. And this is the timing that our fluid resuscitation might have greater impact in outcomes, in contrast to the later resuscitation, that is between hour six up to the completion of day two, which is more dependent on patient's response. So if the patients continue to be hypotensive, we're going to be giving more fluids, and so on and so forth. However, acute pancreatitis complications might have already been established, and this later resuscitation might actually result in a reverse causation bias, meaning that, yes, we're giving more fluids to those that are not doing well. And that clearly is a limitation of prospective trials that are not randomized, as I mentioned. And then moving into pilot randomized controlled trials now, and we're going to focus in this slide on the rate of IV fluids. Back in 2010, we had the first study from China that enrolled 115 patients with predicted severe pancreatitis. And those patients, as you can see, they were randomized in a rapid hemodilution arm, where the goal was to fast drop the hematocrit to less than 35% in 48 hours, versus a standard arm where the goal hematocrit was and the resuscitation approach was less aggressive. And actually, this study showed the opposite results from what we expected. The rapid hemodilution arm had higher, significantly higher percentage of development of sepsis and death. Granted, this is a study coming from China, but the results to many of us were, in a way, unexpected. Combining those results with the results of the study by Di Madaria that I mentioned before, the pancreatology community started thinking, do we really help the patients with early vigorous resuscitation or not? Following that, in 2011, there was a pilot randomized controlled trial led by Beach and Hu, where compared goal-directed with a very well-thought approach of 20 mLs per kilogram bolus upon enrollment, followed by 3 or 1.5 mLs per kilogram per hour, depending on the BUN level of the patients, with a couple of checkpoints within 24 hours, versus physician-directed approach. Unfortunately, this study showed no difference in the approach, mainly because more or less the amount of fluids that two arms were provided was very similar, around 4 liters. And in studies like that, separation between the two arms is very important, and unfortunately, the study by Wu failed to achieve a significant separation between the two arms. And most recently, James Baxbaum group from South California also reported on a small pilot randomized controlled trial in patients with expected or predicted mild acute pancreatitis, where they were randomized into an aggressive arm with 20 mL per kilogram bolus, followed by 3 mL per kilogram per hour infusion rate, versus a non-aggressive arm that exactly the half of the amount of fluids were given, and they used a composite clinical outcome that they called clinical improvement, and showed that in those patients that they were aggressively resuscitated the first 36 hours, there was significantly higher clinical improvement. So as you can see, the results that we have right now in regards to the rate of IV fluids from pilot randomized controlled trials are kind of split, correct? The study of Mao showed to us that maybe over-resuscitation or aggressive resuscitation might be harmful. The study by Baxbaum showed the opposite. However, the target group here was predicted mild patients, whereas the results of the study by Wu showed no difference. So, where do we stand with fluid resuscitation studies in acute pancreatitis? As you can see, there are studies with improved and detrimental outcomes, and we're kind of split in the middle. We talked about the rate of fluids, but another important element is the type of fluids. These days, we mainly focus on two different types of crystalloid fluids, and this is the lactated ringers and the normal saline. And as you can see, in general, the lactated ringers, it's a more balanced solution, closer to the patient's plasma and serum, both in the concentration of sodium as well as chloride. But in addition, lactated ringers, in contrast to normal saline, also contains lactate, but also contains a small amount of calcium as well. Where do we stand as far as randomized control trials with in respect to the type of fluids? We mainly have three recent randomized control trials that have compared LR or lactated ringers with normal saline. The first one is the study that we already mentioned by Beechen that enrolled 40 patients. And even though they didn't show a that was a 2x2 study, even though they didn't show a difference in respect with the rate, in respect to the type of fluids, they showed that lactated ringers reduced SIRS significantly, as well as the CRP level compared to normal saline at 24 hours. Again, this is not a strong, solid outcome, but clearly it's a promising finding. Following there, then we had a single center study recently published by Thailand that included 47 patients. They used goal-directed therapy and they randomized patients between, again, LR and normal saline. And again, the findings were very similar. They did find that LR reduced the 24-hour SIRS, but not the 48-hour SIRS compared to normal saline. And then the third study by Europe, again, a single center pilot trial of 40 patients, goal-directed therapy again, comparing LR with normal saline. You can see again that LR reduced compared to normal saline, the 48-hour CRP and the 70-hour CRP level, but not the 48-hour and 72-hour SIRS levels. So where do we stand with these three small studies? Granted, the outcomes that they were assessed, they were, I would say, not very strong outcomes. However, it appears that, at least in my eyes, that LR is at least as good or maybe a little bit better than normal saline. So, from those four or five small pilot randomized control trials that have been published the last 7 to 8 years, what can we summarize? Unfortunately, all those studies have small sample sizes. The sample size ranged between 40 and 115. Many studies, these studies also assessed heterogeneous population. You saw that some studied assessed patients that were predicted to have moderately or severe disease. Some studies assessed patients with predicted mild disease. Some studies assessed both. They used varying resuscitation protocols. They have different clinical endpoints, and as we said, both CRP and SIRS changes are kind of soft endpoints. And I wouldn't even consider them that much clinical endpoints. And my understanding of those randomized control trials is that it is not clear right now if early aggressive fluid resuscitation is better than early conservative fluid resuscitation. And it appears also that lactated ringers is at least equal, if not better, to normal saline. So this is some prospective data, which are very recent. They actually represent current practice. These data were accumulated between 2006 and 2018 from eight centers in the United States, most of them being referring tertiary centers. This is the data of 330 patients. And as you can see, these subjects were directly admitted. These are no transfers within eight US sites. And these subjects were actually enrolled into the prospective apprentice database within 48 hours from pain onset. And what do we see in this diagram? As you can see, in the x-axis, we have IV fluids, and we actually assess them as far as volume per weight, correct? And what you can see is that there is a significant variance, both in the amount of IV fluids across the different sites, but also within the sites. That tells me that clinicians in the US currently, they do not have a universal approach as far as how to treat patients with IV fluids. So some clinicians might be supporters of an aggressive fluid resuscitation. Some clinicians might be more conservative. But, and this practice to me is actually supported by the evidence that it's not very clear. So clearly there is more work needed to be done in this field. And over the last couple of years, a group of us is working on a trial that we call it RAPTOR. RAPTOR stands for Early Fluid Resuscitation in Acute Pancreatitis Trial. And I will try to explain to you the rationale and concept for this trial. So our main goal is to compare the safety and efficacy of aggressive versus conservative early fluid resuscitation in acute pancreatitis. This would be a prospective, multi-center, double-blind, randomized controlled trial. Again, early fluid resuscitation impact. By early fluid resuscitation, we mean the first 24 hours with Ringer's lactate on the clinical outcomes in consecutive acute pancreatitis patients presented in the emergency room. The trial will have two different clinical endpoints. For those patients that are CIRS positive at baseline, our primary clinical endpoint will be the development of moderately severe or severe pancreatitis as defined by the revised Atlanta classification, or in-hospital death. For those patients that they are CIRS negative at baseline because of the risk of them developing of moderately severe or severe disease is very low, is less than 10%, the primary outcome will be hospital-free days. By hospital-free days, we're defining as days alive out of the hospital before day 30. Why do we use hospital-free days and not length of stay? Because in those unlikely scenarios that a patient dies, it's very hard to reflect that in the length of stay, whereas for the hospital-free days, they get a zero, so meaning there were no hospital-free days out of the hospital. On top of that, our goal is, since we're going to be doing all this extensive work, to establish a biospecimen repository with serial blood collections for future biomarker and genetic studies. The sample size calculation for the study is 900 subjects. So as you can understand, this study will be a completely different beast as far as the size compared to the previous pilot studies, of which patients 340 will be CIRS positive and 560 will be without CIRS upon presentation. And this is the randomization schema for the RAPTOR trial. So patients with presented with acute pancreatitis and SIRS, within 6 hours from being diagnosed with acute pancreatitis, they will be enrolled and randomized either to aggressive fluids for 24 hours versus a non-aggressive fluid resuscitation protocol. And those protocols will be goal directed. And then those without SIRS, again, they're going to be randomized with different types of fluids. Now, I have to mention that the aggressive fluid resuscitation and the non-aggressive fluid resuscitation protocols will be the same both in the SIRS and the no-SIRS group. So again, the participants will be randomized within 6 hours from the lipase report. So our goal is really to perform an early fluid resuscitation study, because we know from past experience that enrolling these patients early, ideally in the emergency room, will make a big difference and will also simulate clinical practice as well. The aggressive early fluid resuscitation protocol will include a bolus of 20 mLs per kilogram initially, and imagine a 75 kilogram patient will receive 1.5 liters of bolus, followed by 2.4 mLs per kilogram per hour, whereas the conservative, this will be a goal-directed approach, so those patients will be assessed at 6 and 12 hours within the study, and those that have a mean arterial pressure of 60 or less, or they have a low urine output of less than 0.5 mLs per kilogram per hour, will receive additional fluid boluses. And the non-aggressive early fluid resuscitation arm will receive exactly half the amount of fluids. That will be 10 milligrams per kilogram bolus, followed by a continuous infusion of 1.2 milligrams per kilogram per hour. And those infusion rates were based on our apprentice prospective data that I recently mentioned to you. And the 2.4 reflects the 75% interquartile range, whereas the 1.2, the 25%. So summarizing, fluid therapy is a key aspect of initial treatment in acute pancreatitis and should be considered as treatment. Pilot randomized control trials have failed to provide a clear answer to us in regards with the rate of IV fluids. We have been working in this prospective randomized control trial, and we hope that the findings from this study, from RAPTOR, will have immediate clinical implications to how we treat early acute pancreatitis, and they will address several key knowledge gaps, included clinical outcome assessments, patient-reported outcomes, and biomarkers and therapeutic targets. But also, this RAPTOR will develop a platform that can be used for intervention trials in acute pancreatitis, and this would be a key step to testing novel treatments. Summarizing, I have to tell you that back in 2008, in this NPF symposium, I was the mentor for one of the gastroenterology fellows back then. His name was Bichen Wu. Now Bichen and myself are co-PIs in this proposal, RAPTOR, and our collaboration started back in 2008 into this meeting. The group also includes David Huang, who is an emergency department and ICU prominent scientist, and Valerie Durkalski from MUSC. We submitted our U34 proposal to NIDDK back in November. We received a competitive score, and within the next few weeks, we'll find out about the final decision. Thank you.